Amen, amen. Praise God, amen. Once again, from whom all blessings flow, we thank God today for another Tuesday night of Bible study. Amen, amen. And before we go any further, we're going to go before the Lord in prayer. We're going to ask you, those of you that are online with us, amen, to submit your prayer requests. And then after which, we're going to be led in prayer tonight, but none other than our very own Bishop Buster Simmons. Amen. Amen. Come on.
Amen.
Question at this time. Amen. God bless you. Amen. I wonder while I'm talking, I would like to just ask for continued prayer for my brother Sean Shaw, and also to Father and all my family. Amen. That God will just continue to lead us, direct us, keep us. Amen. Amen. In Jesus' name. And also a prayer for my brother-in-law who's in Beth Israel Hospital, Minister David Earl Gillespie. Also to my granddaughter's grandmother, Nayland, grandmother, Iola Golden. Amen. She's in St. Barnabas, but they're actually getting ready to take her to a rehabilitation facility. She's 90 years old. Amen, amen. We just want to keep her lifted up in prayer and the family as well. Amen. If there are any other prayer requests, come on and share. Amen. Amen. God bless.
Thank you, Jesus. Pray for the Latham, Riley, Williams, and Jones family.
Amen, amen.
Continue to pray for the McLean family. Also, I don't know their last name. I call her Shay Shay. Her husband passed away last night. Hello. Pray for all of the Reed families.
Amen.
God will sustain this, them during this hour.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Amen.
Pray for all the children.
Amen.
Pray for the first lady.
Amen. God bless you.
Amen. Amen.
Any other requests?
Pray for Dr. Perkins and her family.
Yes.
Amen.
Absolutely. Amen. Absolutely. Believe
God. Yes. Just continue that God will hear the prayers of the people that we already prayed for. I'm not going to name them today, name by name. God knows who they are. And I'm asking for a special prayer for Shiloh Temple.
Amen.
You know, the building, the grounds, and above all, pray for the church that comes into Shiloh Temple.
Amen.
That God would give them a leading and a healing spirit.
Yes.
We know that sometimes it's hard for us to be who we are. So we want to pray for the church in us.
Yeah.
God look and put his hands on his people of God.
Amen. All right, any other requests?
I know. They done took that thing out of her. I know.
Excuse me, one more thing. Mm-hmm. Pray for the two sisters that came into the church Sunday.
Wow. Amen.
That God will keep their mind on a fast, straight, and narrow.
Yes.
You know, that they will continue to come worship with us.
Amen.
Absolutely.
Lord. Pray that the people that we reached out to will come too.
Amen.
That they'll come.
Yes, Lord. Amen. Anyone else? Amen. Before we turn it over to our bishop. Amen. If there's not any other prayer requests, we'll ask at this time.
One more thing. Pray that the pastor has a blessed Sunday.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Amen. Amen.
Will be a blessing to him,
amen.
A blessing to the church.
Amen.
You know, we're going to pray that we're going to have one of the most beautiful times that God had gave his people down here on earth.
Amen.
Absolutely. We believe God. Amen. All right. All right. If that's it, we're going to turn it over to another than our very own Bishop Pastor Simmons, to lead us in prayer tonight. Amen. God bless you.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes. Can't see you.
Okay.
Hear you.
Yeah. Oh.
I think some. Oh, you lost your audio too just now.
Thank you, Lord.
We lost the audio. Yeah.
My microphone is muted. My microphone
is muted. We hear you.
Okay, because it won't unmute it. I'm trying to unmute it.
No, we hear you.
You're not muted.
Hear us?
We hear you, but we don't see you.
Oh, okay. I don't know what's going on with this thing.
Video just went out. That's all right.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right, let's look to the Lord. Father, we do thank you and bless you
for
this day that you have made,
that
we have come to rejoice and to be glad in it. God, we look to you because you're the author and the finisher of our faith.
Yes,
we do
Lord.
Know that it's in you that we live, we move, and have our entire being.
Amen.
And even right now, God, we know that there are so many things that the enemy tries to do. So many attempts, so many onslaughts that he tries to put in the midst of us. But we know, God, that we have the victory through the Lord Jesus Christ. And even right now, God, so many prayer requests have went up. Requests for families, requests for children, requests for individuals that are in the hospitals, individuals that are going into reservation homes, God. We know, God, that there is much trouble in the land. But we know, God, that you are able to do exceeding and abundantly. And even right now, we turn all of these things over to you.
Yes.
We turn them over to you because we have come to the right situation.
Yes.
We have come to the right purpose. And God, you will do with these things exactly what needs to be done.
Yes.
God, we don't want our will to be done, but we want your will to be done.
Yes.
Not what we think, God, but what you desire. Because your ways are not our ways and your thoughts are not our thoughts.
Yes.
And God, we have to give over to your will. We've got to give over to what you desire and move ourselves out of the way, move our individualism out of the way. As long as you get the glory,
yes.
As long as you get the honor, as long as you get the praise. And you said that if you just be lifted up, you would draw men, women, boys, and girls. And God, we want to be able to lift you up even in the neighborhood, even around the areas that we happen to impact with. God, you told us that we are the salt of the earth. But you said, what good is that salt if it's lost its savor?
Yes, God.
You said it's therefore good for nothing but to be trampled under the feet of men.
Yes.
God, help us to be able to see what you have in store for us, that what you have down the road, what you have in your vision. Make the vision clear and plain. Help us to be able to gird behind the pastor and be able to lift him up, God, and to be able to help
do Lord.
Whatever needs to be done. Not our program, God, but what you desire. Help us, God, to be able to shoulder those things that need to be done, those things
you,
that need to be dealt with. Help us to be able to be a help. Help us to be able to be individuals that would support. God, we know that if you do it, it shall be done.
Yes.
If you help us, we shall be helped. If you bless us, we shall be blessed. If you heal us, we shall be healed.
Yes.
And God, we believe you. Right now, we believe
right
you
now.
For the victory, even right now.
Yeah,
we hold
now.
Satan even at bay, even right now, that he can go here and no further. We draw a line in the sand that he cannot go no further than right here. And this is where it canceled. This is where it's over. This is where it's done. And God, help us to be able to lift you up high. Help us to be able to be that light shining in the midst of the wilderness.
Yes.
That somebody would see that there's a reality in serving a true and living God.
God,
we want to be able to be a blessing to the kingdom. We want to be able to be a blessing to the kingdom. We want to be able to be a blessing to the kingdom. We don't want to be dead weight. We don't want to be inactive. We don't want to be troublesome. But help us to be able to be a blessing to the kingdom. Because when it's all done and when everything is finished, we expect you to be able to say, well done. And faithful servant.
Yes.
You've been faithful
about
a few things.
Amen.
Now
amen.
Come on up a little higher and enter into the joy of the Lord. Help us, God, to meet that situation. Help us to be able to accomplish that goal. For we know, God, if you do it, it shall be done. If you do it, it shall be accomplished. And this is our prayer today, even with all those prayers that have been prayed. Bless them, God.
Yes.
Lift them up where they belong.
Thank
Make
you,
the crooked edges straight. Make the situations wrong right. We believe you right now, God, as you make it happen. As you make it happen. As you make it happen.
Yes.
What is our prayer? In Jesus' mighty name.
In Jesus' name.
We pray
in Jesus'
today.
Name.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
God be the glory.
Woo,
God. Yes, Lord. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Yes.
Amen. Thank you for the
yes.
God bless you. Amen. Amen.
My God. My God.
Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Family and friends. Amen. We saints of God, we're going to get ready to go right into our Bible study. I'm going to do screen share. One moment, please. Amen. Our subject on tonight that we're going to be dealing with is resolving conflict. That's going to be our Bible study and discussion for tonight. Amen. 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 I'm going to ask you to put your devices on mute. Amen. As we go through this lesson on tonight. Amen. Resolving conflict. Amen. We believe we have some awesome information for you on tonight. I encourage you to take notes. Amen. On tonight. Amen. Resolving conflict. This will be our Bible study for tonight. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Conflict. Even with the best intentions, even when we have the best intentions, when we do things, when we partake of things in this life, conflicts can arise. Conflict can arise. Now, we see the presence of interpersonal challenges and oftentimes in conflicts in big and small ways within our families, friendship, communities, cities, throughout our society even. And from a counseling perspective, we can also see also too how the presence of conflict is also linked to factors such as miscommunication, mismatched messages, personal perspectives, and also to a lack of active listening skills. These elements collected throughout our lifetime largely contribute as to how we handle disagreements as well as disputes. And although our upbringing, life experiences, and personal differences mold our unique approach to conflict, we can all agree that when conflict is left unresolved, what happens? It can cause unnecessary distresses in our lives, and even in our relationships. I want to put a couple of questions to you on tonight, family and friends. So listen, one moment, we have more people coming in the room. So this question is this, one question. How do we begin to navigate the tension within topics that trigger us without becoming consumed by the conflict itself? How do we do that? Next question. Even more importantly, what does the Bible say about how we're to handle conflict in healthy ways? Listen, I want to share some points of study that we're going to deal with on tonight. Points of study.
Mm-hmm.
The core of the conflict. The core of the conflict. All right, the conflict has a root. And I have an acronym that we're going to deal with on tonight. I like to refer to it as CALM, C-A-L-M. All right. That in that calm is the essence of four strategies for us in the midst of conflict. We're getting the background noise. One moment. All right. We got it. All right. What are some of those? What are those 4 points? Number one, connect. When we're dealing with conflict, how do we connect? Number two, when we're dealing with conflict, how to assess? How to assess? Number three, when dealing with conflict, this is important, family and friends, how to listen? How to listen? Number four, when dealing with conflict, how to maintain? How to maintain your integrity, your stability, amen. How to maintain yourself, amen, when dealing with conflict. All right, we want to study, talk about these points on tonight. All right, I just want to outline, if you will, some strategies. Listen, there's many types of methods that are used to reduce high conflict situations. Many of these strategies, in fact, can be applied to our interpersonal interactions. And unlike the tactics that are used in arguments and debates, conflict resolution skills does what? It provides a strategy for maintaining structure and self-awareness while, in fact, seeking to do what? To find common ground in our communication. And let's look at four of these strategies supported by scripture that can develop our ability to dialogue and also to deepen our awareness of our internal process to do what? In essence, to seek peace. Amen. Going back to the acronym, CALM, C-A-L-M. Let's look at the first letter of that. The first letter of that is connect. Connect. Now, listen, connection is in fact the first step in conflict resolution. Why? Because it creates what? A path for collaborative communication. And in most conflicts, communication is unclear if a connection is not established. Now, just think about this. Think about the last time you may even tried to resolve a conflict over a text message or a phone call. Did it end well? I actually had that experience with someone some years ago. You know, trying to resolve a conflict, tried to do it through a text message. That didn't go so well. I'm a witness. And most of the time, the answer is no. Why? Because without the human connection, communication, in fact, becomes complicated. And it's like the equivalent of trying to play catch back to back with someone. How will we catch the ball if we can't see it? Watch the process and in fact interact with the person. The same actually in fact goes for resolving conflict. Intentional and disarming connection simply seek to be present in the conflict. It does not in fact avoid or minimize or escalate or excuse. Now, linking this concept back to scripture, I think it's safe to say that Jesus, in fact, was the best at connecting with people. And if you have ever read the gospel account of Jesus' ministry, you know of the many interactions where Jesus used connection skills to diffuse defensiveness, comfort those, in fact, of which they were in crisis, and communicate it clearly. That's what Jesus did. Listen, in Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 through 24, Jesus warns us, in fact, of the consequences of avoiding conflict and instructs the believer to do what? To seek resolution with others before giving offers to the Lord, saying, I believe around verse 23 and 24, he talks about this. He said, so if you're offering to your gift at an altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, what must you do? You must be reconciled to your brother and then come to your gift. So listen, so if we're in fact to engage in communicating where there has in fact been conflict, we need to learn how to connect as Christ did so that no one, and I mean no one, falls short of the grace of God and that no bitter roots grow up and to cause trouble. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 15 talks about this. There's some skills that we can learn in regards to connecting. Listen to this here. Here's just a few connection skills that could help us to in our communication. We need to set aside what? A time and place for communication to occur. Make time for connection is key. Also, too, we must clearly state your thoughts and feelings. Look what I have on the screen. When blank happens, in other words, when this particular thing may have happened, I felt blank, what? A certain way, maybe. Because what? Because of what had happened or what had transpired. All right? Stating clearly your thoughts and your feelings. And you need to support the conversation with what? With problem solving. What is getting in the way of us trying to get this resolved? What can we do to fix this? Come, my brother, come, my sister, let's reason together. And we need to also invite collaboration. What would you be willing to take a talk through this with me about in regards to this about? We got to collaborate, come together. All right, that brings me to point number two. In regards to our strategic skills in dealing with conflict. The first one was C, connect. The second one is assess. Number two, listen, when conflicts arise, it is also important to assess what our perspective of the situation. And it is, in fact, from this, our perspective, that we often respond. Y'all know that's true. You know, you're always looking through your own lens. But we got to therefore learning how to assess the thoughts and beliefs and feelings associated with conflict can help us do what? Can in fact help us to communicate more clearly, maintain also to a connection, and in fact reduce verbal altercations, all right? When you learn to assess the thoughts, beliefs, and feelings associated with the conflict, all right? That can help us communicate more clearly, maintain a connection, and reduce verbal altercations. Think about this. Think about the last time you were involved in an argument or even a difficult decision. What did you feel physically? Was it hard to, in fact, communicate your thoughts? What was the beliefs about the person or situation that contributed, in fact, to the conflict? Listen, by learning to assess our visceral and emotional responses to interpersonal stress, we can learn to balance our internal process while keeping the peace. Listen, scripture does what? It encourages this introspective approach to conflict resolution. We read in Proverbs 15, this is good stuff here. We read in Proverbs 15 that a soft answer, when he talks about soft, that means gentle. Answer turns away wrath, but a grievous, or we could also refer to that as harsh, word does what? It stirs up anger. And the heart of the righteous ponders how to answer, but the mouth of the wicked pours out evil things. That's Proverbs 15, verse number 1, also verse 28. In Proverbs chapter 12 and verse 18, we read, there is that speaketh like. In other words, somebody of which is reckless in the way of which they speak, piercing of a sword. But the tongue of the wise does what? Brings health. Health. And when you have health, it refers to healing. Listen, the ideal of tempering our response to conflict is also discussed in the book of James chapter 3. We read of the damage of our words can have if we do not actively assess and surrender ourselves to the wisdom of God, which is first pure, then peaceable, then is gentle, open to reason, full of mercy, good fruit, impartial, and sincere. James chapter 3, verse 17. We're in the book on tonight. All right, I must say that again. Listen. We read the damage of our words and they can have if we do not assess and surrender ourselves to the wisdom of God, because that's what should come first and foremost, which is what? First, pure, peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. James 3:17. There's some skills that we can learn in regards to this. Here's just a few of the skills for self-regulation to help us assess all right, which is the second letter of the acronym that I shared with you from the beginning, C-A-L-M. Here's some skills. Listen, question, ask yourself, what thoughts or beliefs or feelings are present? Make an assessment of yourself. Be truthful with yourself. Bodily aware. Become aware of how your body holds the stress of the tension. And then, and understanding that, you need to relax. Calm down. Get a grip. Get a hold of yourself. Breathe. Move if you have to. Count. Most importantly, you need to be praying. Amen. Listen, that brings us to number three. We talked about connecting. We talked about assessing ourselves. Number three, you need to listen. You got to listen. Listen, how well do you listen? You know what I found out, family and friends? I found out that listening is the key to keeping conflict to a minimum. When we make an effort to simply listen to another person without interjecting or disputing with what they have to say, defensiveness is diffused much more quickly. And especially when you got conflict going on and two people hollering back and forth at each other, you can't hear nobody if you're talking and they talking at the same time. There has to be an exchange. Somebody's got to listen first. Then somebody speak. Then after that person finished speaking, then you talk and they listen. All right? Our endeavor should be to try to diffuse it, any type of conflict. Listen, but even in interpersonal conflict, listening becomes difficult if we have not, in fact, established a connection with the other person or assessed our interpersonal perspectives. Amen. And as we are saints of God, if you are a saint of God, amen, amen, amen. We talk about it, but we have to be led of the Spirit. Amen. And there's only one Holy Spirit. Amen. But what oftentimes happens to us, truth be told, amen, amen, we get off the train. We don't follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. Then that's when confusion starts. That's when conflicts take place. You know, the enemy is the devil. He's the author of confusion. He wants to kill, steal, destroy. That's his job. That's the thief. Amen. Amen. But listen, but if we begin a conversation on the defense, even with the perception that the others in the conversation is against us, and oftentimes people have that mindset, what we will hear will reflect those perceptions than what is reality oftentimes. And as a result, we can assume another's feeling. And that distorts the message of other words. Listen, that's why James implored us in the scriptures, believers saying, know this, that my beloved brethren, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. For the anger of a man does not produce the righteousness of God. Listen, these instructions started by listening for a reason. Can you think of a time when you misunderstood someone due to your lack of actively listening? Maybe you spoke too soon, or you became upset over something that was simply not true. Listen, when we limit our listening in conflict, we will inevitably become angry. James, in the scriptures, he reminds us that anger does not result in any sort of positive outcome and therefore must be exchanged for God's word, which does what? Which transforms our souls. That's talked about in James chapter 1, verses 20 through 21. There's some skills that we can learn in regards to listening. Listen, in addition to listening to God's word and voice in our lives, here's some practical skills for us that in fact will increase our listening ability within conflict. We need to do what? We need to be reflecting on others' feelings and thoughts. Can I see how that would be frustrating? Ask even with an open-ended question. What about our disagreement? What about it that upsets you the most, my brother, my sister? And seek for clarification. So you're upset because you're feeling I am what? All right. seek for clarification. And that brings me to the final letter in our acronym of CALM, C-A-L-M. M for what? For maintain. Number four, maintain. Finally, hear this on tonight. The goal of conflict resolution is to maintain unity in our relationship, glory to God, and to restore our connection with others. Yet I submit to you on tonight that I believe it's important to note that there are times and specific situations, such as with the pattern of abuse or emotional maltreatment, in which reconciliation may not occur or be prolonged due to a lack of repentance. That's talked about in Luke chapter 17, verse number 3. Listen, scripture does what? It commissions interpersonal forgiveness and instructs us as believers to seek reconciliation with one another quickly. I say again, we seek reconciliation quickly. Yet in situations of conflict that result in deep hurt, broken trust, illegal behavior, the maintenance of unity and restoration might take time. And in some cases may not occur if the offender is unwilling to acknowledge their wrongdoing and pursue change. Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 through 19. And in most cases of conflict, maintaining unity and restoring wholeness is the fact of achievable goal. It should be our endeavor to maintain unity and restore wholeness. Restoration, glory to God, that should be our goal. The importance of this mindset is what? It helps to differentiate, in fact, the problem from the person involved and approach the conflict from what? A more collaborative perspective. Listen, if our goal is to be on your side and maintain holiness, we need to work together. Apostle Paul, he speaks, in fact, on this concept of maintaining unity by saying what? He said, make every effort to keep the unity of the spirit of the bond of peace, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 3. So how do we begin to make an effort to maintain this unity when conflict, in fact, arises? Paul, he speaks to some specific ways in following the verses of Ephesians 4, saying this. You got to put off falsehood, speaking truth to your neighbor. And for we are what? We are all members of one body. In your anger, don't sin. Do not let your sun go down while you're still angry. All right? King James, don't let the sun go down in your wrath. Do not give devil a foothold. Don't give place to the devil. Do not let any unwholesome talk come even out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for the building of others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who hear, those who listen. Ephesians 4, 25, verses 20 through 27, also verse 29. There's some skills that we could learn in regards to us maintaining. Here we are given three great skills for maintaining unity when conflict arises. We got to speak honestly, use openness, honesty when addressing conflict. Speak quickly, share your frustrations as soon as possible. Speak respectfully, speak in terms of we versus you. In conclusion, now that we have several skills to practice and scriptures to reflect on, it is my prayer, family and friends, that we will begin to pursue the peace of Christ's wholeness in our conflicts, because conflicts are going to come. But we want to deal with it, amen, quickly and efficiently according to the scriptures, and to take first steps in restoring our relationships. Remember this, everyone. Conflict is inevitable, but it's how we approach it that makes all the difference. I say that again. Conflicts are inevitable. You're going to have disagreements. You're going to have, there will be some stuff that will arise that you may not see eye to eye on. Yes, it's going to happen. But it's how we approach it that makes the difference. I'm going to stop right there. Stop screen share. All right. All right, you can unmute everyone. And we want to talk further in regards to this subject matter. Yeah. All right, resolve and color. God bless you. How you doing? All right.
Hi. Hi.
All right. Glad to have you on today, Spark. Amen. God bless you and Mama. All right. All right, so let's just talk about this even further, everyone, and share in regards to resolving conflict. All right? Anyone have any questions also, too, in regards to this lesson? Please ask your question. All right? Amen. Thank God for everyone on tonight that's on with us. There were some other scriptures, too, that I was looking at, too, even in the Word of God. Also, too. Amen. Amen. Colossians chapter 3, if you're taking notes, write this down. Colossians chapter 3, verse 13. He said, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do you. Amen. All right. And I shared with you already in my presentation, Ephesians chapter 4. Actually, that's in the fourth chapter. Actually, did verse 26. Be angry. Yes, there's going to be times in your life you're going to get upset. You're going to get angry. But don't sin. Don't let the sun go down on your ass. All right? And you know what I love with Jesus? Remember the Beatitudes? And I think a lot of us need to really read those and reflect on those at least once a week, if not more. And Matt, when Jesus taught the multitude in Matthew chapter 5, in verse number 9, he talks about, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. All right, so that lets me know, even in that scripture right there, that there is a characteristic of the child of God. The child of God is a peacemaker, you know. And he's not going to start contention. He's not going to be trying to fight or even when conflict try to arise, or you may feel differently about a particular thing. Come, let us reason together. Let's talk. Let's talk about whatever the conflict, the way, whatever I may feel a certain way about. Let's talk. Let's deal with this as the Word of God instructs us and tells us how to deal with it. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they should be called the children of God. Oh, glory to God. Amen? Listen. There's many more scriptures that I could even share and go even into the Word of God. But our endeavor as a people in the body of Christ, amen, is we want to make the devil out of a liar. Again, I say, amen, amen. The enemy is the author of confusion. He loves to stir up in mess. He loves to create mess. He loves conflict. You know, that's his job. All right, that's his job. And the last time I know, he ain't coming down from his job. Amen. If you're taking notes, you could write this down. Amen. 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 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 6. I referenced it, but I want to give you exact scripture. 14 chapter verse 33. But God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. All right. If we're children of the Most High God, we are children of peace. Amen. He makes reference to that so many times in scriptures. Amen. Not of ourselves. Amen. 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 Oftentimes, you know, even when you feel that you're right, or even when you may be right, you know, sometimes you just gotta, like I pointed out even in the beginning of my presentation, and I reference scripture, you got to be slow to speak. You got to, you know, listen, you know, don't be so quick to just, you know, just get set off just like a firecracker. Calm down, take a breath. You know, that's what the enemy wants to do. He wants to, you know, he wants to cause mess. That's his job. And even after, you know, and oftentimes, and we gotta, the Bible says, for we are not weary concerning his devices. That's what he wants to do. God does a great thing through us, in us, and here comes the enemy sticking up his ugly, nasty head to try to cause contention. But the devil is a liar. We're not going to give no place to the enemy. And we don't want our good to even be evil spoken of, you know, because we are the ambassadors of the Most High God. You know, and believe it or not, when we don't think the world's not even paying attention to us and looking at us, they are watching you, beloved. They're watching you. They're watching your every move. And even when you don't even see them, guess what? They see you. They hear you a lot of times, too. You know, that's why we got to make sure that our conversation is correct when we talk so much importantly to each other and how we rep ourselves in the community and places that we go. We got to be so careful. Amen. Amen. And we got to resolve at all costs, as saints of the Most High God, we got to resolve conflict. Resolve conflict. Amen. So anybody have any questions in regards to what I've shared? I know I kind of gave a lot of information already. Does anybody have a question?
Praise God, church. Praise God, church family.
God bless you,
David. I was reading in Psalms 141, and it said, "Lord, help me control my tongue."
That's
and
it.
My father told me long time ago when I was about 12 or 13, he said, "Only a fool talk all the time, but a wise man listen." And as the lesson that we was going through tonight, it said, before you open your mouth, you have to assess the situation.
Right.
Because how many times have I seen people, they walk in on that tail end of an argument, and they made this big scene when the only thing they had to do was be quiet and listen. And then another point that I want to bring out, we are a church family. That's what we are. And we striving to be Christ-like. If we striving to be Christ-like, we supposed to show love, be meek, be humble. No one person know everything. I can't get into an uproar because my sister in Christ trying to tell me something. I cannot do that. And I represent myself as a Christian woman. As a Christian woman, my behavior should reflect what I'm striving to be. God bless y'all.
Amen. Amen. Absolutely. You know, a tree is known by the fruits it bear. Amen, amen, amen. The fruit is the evidence of what that tree is. Amen. And I love what Mavis said in that last part. Amen. If we're saying that we Christ-like, we got to demonstrate that and exhibit that. Amen. Reflective of what the scriptures define that as. Amen. Anything outside of that is not of God. Anything of it. And you know what? There was one of our mothers of our church, my late Gladys Perkins. And I actually, my mother also said it too. She said it off the top. She said, if you can't find yourself in the Word of God, you just can't be found. You know, you just can't be found. So that's the key, beloveds. Amen. Those of you that are watching us, amen. Make sure that you're found in the Word of God.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
And make sure that your life, amen, is reflective, amen, as to what Jesus has instructed us and shared with us and told us as to how to live and even to conduct ourselves. All throughout the scriptures. Amen. 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 Resolving conflict. That's our subject on tonight. Amen. Praise God. That's our endeavor to do. Amen. Again, as I said in the beginning, at the outset, conflicts are going to come. There's going to be many times you just going to disagree. Amen. It's just going to happen, you know? But we can, there's a way for us to disagree in a righteous way, you know? We are saints of the Most High God. We got to remember, we're in the world, but we should not be of the world. You don't resolve things like the world resolves, you know. And you know how the world do. They get so mad, they get up in your face, and next thing you know, fists and hands and knees and foots and everything else swinging. Then after that, somebody's ready to grab a bat. Somebody's ready to grab a knife. Somebody's ready to grab a... Y'all know it.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, that's the world. But we're supposed to be the epitome of what Jesus, amen, amen, Christ, amen, is like. Amen? We're supposed to represent him. I said it before in times past. Amen. We're ambassadors. That means you're a representative. When we talk about an ambassador of a country, amen, that person goes on behalf of the country to a different nation to represent the nation of which he came from. That's an ambassador. And you're the greatest, in regards to an ambassador of Jesus Christ, you're the greatest ambassador on planet Earth. Amen. Amen. And our life and the way we conduct ourselves, the way we carry ourselves, that should be reflective of that. Nothing else. Nothing else.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. And we got to get out of this. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people do. They get into this thing, you know. You can't think more highly of yourselves than you ought. You got to come down. Humbleness is mm-hmm. the way. Humbleness is the way. You know? And oftentimes when you think you're right, just go to the Lord and pray. Don't be so quick to snap. Amen. Somebody step on your foot. You ready to smack the fool out of them. Come on now. Amen. You got to learn to be humble. Humble. And don't mm-hmm. be so quick to, and remember what I talked about in the presentation. Oftentimes, amen, and Sister Mavis made a good point. Oftentimes somebody will look at something and don't know what a conversation was, but they'll assess a situation by what they saw at a moment and didn't even see the whole thing.
But don't even know the whole thing.
Don't even know the whole thing, yeah. Come on now. You got to, come on. Amen. Listen. We as children of mm-hmm. God, amen, God wants us to do all things in decency and order. And we have an art with our brother or sister. Amen. 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 Listen. You go to them in a peaceful way. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Not trying to blaze nobody out, and you know, I'm gonna scream at you so loud. No, I'm gonna scream at you louder. you know, come on. That ain't getting nowhere. That's not of God. That's not of God. Amen.
Amen.
Follow peace with all men, for holiness without no man shall see the Lord. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord, Pastor.
Right. Go ahead, D. Go ahead.
You talk about conflict. There's different types of conflict. Because if you're married and whatnot, you got a conflict just about every day.
All right, Deacon Ray.
I mean, I'm just telling you.
Listen, you know what? Listen, I'm in that same banana boot.
It could be a small thing or whatever, but there still be conflict.
And guess what?
You know what I'm saying?
You got it. And even with that, and I said that. I said there's always going to be conflict. It's how you deal with it that matters.
But I think about Job, you know, when he told a woman, she come out and said, curse your God and die. Mm. You know what I'm saying? There's going to be conflict with the thing about it. You never let the conflict get into you where you shame God.
That's it.
Mm. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
another good way.
Yeah, you understand? Yeah. No matter, you know, like he said, though you slay me, I'm not gonna change up.
Right.
You know, and like I said, you know, like you said, the enemy got people watching us.
Yes, he does.
At all times. When we think don't nobody see or hear, they duck.
They're hearing.
And you know, we got to be careful. You know, I was thinking about, you know, how we use that thing, tell the truth and shame the devil.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Saints should always be telling the truth, and the devil should always be shamed.
Absolutely.
Amen.
We shouldn't have to tell a saint, tell the truth. Mm. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, it's a good thing, but we're supposed to be in the spirit of the Lord that whatever we say and do, to our knowledge, is the truth. Mm-hmm. And if we did that, the devil will always be shamed.
Yep.
You know, but a good lesson. I like the way you did it, the four calm pieces of calm, you know, and like I say, we not only got to be heroes of the word, we got to be doers.
Absolutely. Absolutely. God bless you, Chief. God bless you.
This Sister Ray, you know, my job, I was a negotiator, and we had to do a conflict resolution. Mm. And one of the things was some of what you said during your presentation, be calm.
Praise God.
Be attentive.
Listen. Maintain.
And maintain. Mm. And there's all mm-hmm. types of different conflicts. And when you're in like a negotiating setting, they're going back and forth, back and forth. Now, before I was the negotiator, I was the note taker. So while they were screaming back and forth, I was taking notes. And when I became the negotiator, I could listen to them and take notes. And then when they finished, I could get my point across. I didn't yell. You can't yell, because once you yell and once you have a certain color and a certain gender, they're going to say you're an angry Black woman or whatever. So if I heard my voice in my ear, that meant I was speaking too loudly. So I would call a caucus until I could get myself calmed down where I could go back and present myself. And I used to tell Overseer Shaw, I always thought about what I represented. I couldn't go in there cussing and fussing and then say, oh, you're a Christian, you saved and you this. You're a child of God, and I was acting just like them. And believe it or not, they started acting more like me. They stopped the yelling, the screaming, the cussing, and they started talking like they had some sense. So it's imperative that you learn those attributes so that you can get the job done and not fall into the devil's trap.
Mm. Awesome. Wow, Sister Ray. I love what you said right there. You said so many great things, but one key thing you said there, you remember what you represented. We got to remember, family and friends, who we represent. Amen. We represent the Most High God. We're ambassadors of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. We got to remember that.
Amen. Because we had two of us that was saying that, you know, we were Christian, we believed in God. Right. And the one girl that I worked with, she said, why Mary don't act like you? I said, you have to ask Mary. I didn't talk against her or anything. I said, you have right. to ask Mary. I got right. to be, you know, who I am, do what I have to do.
Mm-hmm. Amen. I must represent and exhibit, amen, and demonstrate and uphold the one of which that sent me. Amen. Glory yeah. to God. Amen. Thank God for you, Sister Ray. That's awesome. That's awesome. You know what? I'm saying, you know what? It goes back to that analogy, just like I'm telling you. If you shine, you know what? If you let your light so shine just enough, amen. He ain't said just enough. He said just let it shine, you know? Men gonna see your good works, glorify the Father. I tell you, stuff gonna rub off on folks. And that's what we want to do. We want to be contagious. We want to be a contagion, amen, as ambassadors for Jesus. Amen.
That's right. That's right.
And I would dare to lie, to live a life of which is a lie, saying that I'm representing God and I'm doing all kinds of other stuff of which is not like it. I dare not do that. Amen.
I don't want to take the retribution of shaming God.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? God ain't nobody to play with.
No, he's not.
You know what I'm saying?
No, he's not.
Yes.
Amen. I pray to listen. I mean heaven all the way.
Yeah.
Man. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Amen.
Anybody, amen. Amen.
Deacon Ray, Deacon Ray, awesome. Anybody else want to share a question?
God bless you. God bless you, Pastor.
God bless you, Bishop.
Yes. I just want to share this. We have to understand with pristine clarity that we are held to a whole different situation of behavior than the world is. One of the situations that always kills the influence of the child of God is when we act the fool. When we act out of character, when we resemble the world. Because then we have lost our influence, we have lost our effectiveness, and we need to understand that yes, we do shame heaven. Yes, we do. I want to make it very clear that we shame heaven when we act out of sorts. James said, and I know you went over, you know, that portion of seven, the fourth chapter of James. Uh-huh. James said clearly, from whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even of your lusts and war in your members? We got to understand that the enemy is sending all kind of ambushments, all kind of bombardments, so that we can lose our influence. We can get people that will decide, listen, that's why I don't go to church. You see that? That's why I don't attend. You see how they act? All of that foolishness that they're dealing with. We've Amen. Got to understand, we've got a higher situation of accountability. And if we don't recognize that, then we're gonna cause a reproach to the body of Christ. A serious reproach. Now, I want to go simply to there's a 2 Corinthians 2.
Uh-huh. Go ahead, Bishop.
There's a scripture there that says Where is it? I gotta make sure I got it because the devil want me to lose it, but I ain't gonna lose it.
That's all right, we there. Go ahead.
All right. Okay. Verse number 11. We got to look at what Paul said in this second letter to the people of Corinth. He said, lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we are not ignorant concerning, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Now, all we got to do is be careless enough to let Satan get an advantage of us. Mm-hmm. And then we go off. That's where we begin to shame heaven. That's where we begin to lose our influence. That's where we get in trouble with God. We got to understand. We went on outreach on Saturday. People came on Sunday. The devil is fighting mad.
Woo, God.
So what he got to do is he got to find some folks that he can get that will give him place.
Come on.
Wow. The Bible says, even in Luke 4 and 13, and when the devil had ended all his temptation, all the temptation, yes, he departed from Jesus for a season.
A season.
You've got to understand that the enemy will never leave you alone. And so when he deals with something, he's going to hit and then he's going to hide. He's going to hit and then he's going to hide. What we have to do is be very, very conscious of the fact that we cannot allow him to be able to get an advantage of us. We can't allow that. We can't allow that. Because what we're gonna do is we're going to actually cause if we are individuals that are Christ-like, if we are individuals that talk about, okay, we're members of the Most High God, then we gotta act like it. We gotta act like it.
At all.
We gotta put our individualistic idiosyncrasies behind us, deal with lifting up Christ, because it's him that's got to get the glory of anything that we deal with. 15 and 35 says, by this shall all men know that you're my disciples. Not because you got a Bible, not because you can sing hymns and all that kind of stuff, not because you can deal with quoting scriptures, but by this shall all men that you're my disciples. How? If you have love one to another. We have to be so intoxic. We have to be so intoxicating in Shiloh that people feel it from the door. That people are actually overwhelmed with it, because we are showing it from heart to heart and from breast to breast, not just on Sunday, but every day that we come around each other, every situation that we interact with each other. We cannot allow the enemy to get any kind of place in our lives. We don't come too far. We don't come too far. We ain't just got saved yesterday. We didn't just get saved last week. And so if we are saved, then act like it. If we are saved, we ought to walk the saved walk. If we are saved, talk the saved talk. And put our personal agendas in the garbage, because that's where they belong. If it ain't about souls, then it ain't about nothing. If it's not a kingdom issue, it ain't about nothing.
Nothing.
And I need to share that with you. Y'all may not like what I'm saying, but I'm telling you the truth, and I'm telling you what God loves. We've got to get off of our high horses, get down off of our situations that we think we in charge and we large and in charge and all that kind of stuff. Ain't nobody in charge but the pastor. And amen. If the pastor don't sign off on it, then that's it. And if he don't approve it or whatever, we got to make sure that we're dealing with the agenda that he sets, because God gives him the vision. I'm just here to be able to help with the provision. But that's what we've got to get about. Leave your agenda at home. Amen. I've got my own amens with me. Y'all don't have to say nothing. I know what I'm talking is right.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, I'm done. Let me stop fussing.
God bless you, sir.
Oh, have mercy, Bishop. Oh, my God.
Yes.
Minister Latham.
God bless you. Amen.
Everything that I was listening to lines up with what God wants us to do. But he also wants us to live the truth. It's all about truth. If you're not hiding things, if things are not what they should be on open, then where is the truth? We have to live the truth. Amen. Okay.
Mm-hmm. This is Brother Latham.
May God bless you. Amen.
This is Brother Latham.
Yes, sir.
God bless you, Pastor. I see you're doing very well tonight, sir. Yeah. God continue blessing you, Bishop. And I got to shout out Kadoodles to our elder. I call him my elder, Juanita Ray. I haven't heard her talk so much on Zoom. But God continue blessing you, elder. Elder Ray.
Oh,
I want to address that age-old conflict. That age-old conflict of good versus evil, okay? And that is resulting to a carnal mind versus a spiritual mind, okay?
Okay.
There's always going to be conflict when you have a carnal-minded person meeting up with a spiritual-minded person. Why? Because a carnal-minded person really cannot understand what where a spiritual-minded person is coming from, okay? And it's not for me to really try to even to understand a condomized person, because he don't understand, or whoever they be, don't understand where I'm coming from as a spiritual person. A condomized thinks really about me, my, which leads to the avenue of vanity, pride, and really worldly lust, okay? Which will slowly but surely causes them to go into a more sinful way of life. You understand? A carnal-minded person will sooner or later start lying, stealing, manipulating, you understand, backbiting. Why? Because they have a self-I agenda. That's really what Satan had, all right? Satan really had an I agenda and my agenda. When a spiritual-minded person always focused on what is righteous in the eyes of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in which he's going to walk, or she is going to walk circumspect, okay? A spiritual-minded person, if a man asks for your shirt, give him your jacket too, all right?
Yes.
That's a spiritual-minded person. Mm-hmm. And really, if you're a spiritual-minded person, you really are blessed and baptized with the Holy Spirit, such that you already discern. Because the Holy Spirit is going to give you that spirit of discernment, what a person desires or needs. All right? But think about it. My, blah, blah, blah. Okay? So a carnal mind does not understand the spiritual aspect of a spiritual man. For the flesh is always, that the Bible says, warring against the spirit. Whenever you get a carnal-minded people and spiritual-minded people in the same curriculum, there's always going to be conflict, because that good versus evil, the flesh versus the spirit, is always going to be warring against them. The reason that there's somewhat controversy within the churches is that's why we always got to walk according to God's and Jesus Christ's example, be the best ambassadors that we can be. Why? Because even the church itself is the hospital. That's where we're going to have, you understand, the backsliders, the ones that are looking to get a closer walk and get to know who he is. That's but when we start talking about he, the people are very aware about God, our creator, God, Abba, our father. They already know that. Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Some of them even know Jesus, the Messiah. But do they know the Holy Spirit? No, they do not. They can walk the walk and they can talk the talk. But you can tell if they have been baptized by the Holy Spirit, because what's in their heart, that fleshly desire, which is in their heart, comes out their mouth. They cannot listen. They can't bait the phone but for so long. Why? Because the adversary is just like Abba Father. He wants to get the glory. Me. My. And if you are a disciple, some people are disciples of the Antichrist. I won't go that far. I'll say the adversary. So the Antichrist is another entity all to itself. So some people really are not even aware that they are really advocates and disciples of the adversary. What Jesus saying? Listen, get away from me. I never knew you. Did I feed the hungry? Did I clothe the homeless? Did I feed the hungry? Yes, you did. But did you have me in your heart? Jesus said, did you have me in your heart? You did those things for self-gratification. You didn't do that. You didn't do that for your love of Jesus. You didn't do that because you wanted God to uplift God, such that people know that God blessed me so I can bless you. So I can bless those that need the blessing. God blessed me with food, so I bless you with food. You understand what I'm saying? That is the way a spiritual mind thinks. But a carnal mind, if God blessed them with an abundance of food supply or whatever it is, the carnal mind will go out there and sell you that year corn for $1.50. Although
He has been given it freely. He will try to sell it to you. Why? Because the adversary's attributes within him is going to have that me, 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 I mentality.
You don't see me.
God bless you. Y'all continue praying for my strength because God still got a lot of work to do on me.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. This is Minister
Bass. I cannot expect a carnal-minded person to know, to even comprehend what a spiritual-minded person is saying. They really can't. They listen, unless you've been baptized, I stress this all the time, you cannot expect they talking about save. You are not saved unless you've been baptized by that burning fire. And you will know the one. Those of us that have been baptized by the burning fire, we can not necessarily discern. We can feel the workings of the Holy Spirit emanating from you. If I don't feel, I could just meet a person. And I know whether they've been baptized by that burning fire. If they haven't been baptized with that burning fire, my spirit tells me God got work to do.
My God, my God.
You can fake it. You can fake it. Listen, there's always against those that are Holy Ghost filled, and I ain't talking about running around speaking in tongues. You understand? Because there's other evidences of the evidence of the Holy Spirit. You're going to walk daily in the fruit, not just on Sunday. You can feed the homeless. You can clothe the needy. But are you doing it for God's glory, such that God get the glory? Are you doing it such that Dallas will get the glory? Continue praying for me, Pastor.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. I heard a few things there that I want to comment on. We know, yes, that first of all, we have to be hearers, right? Those who have an ear, let them hear. Some things were said, but maybe some things that were said because they have not heard what the message was. Okay, and that we don't want to judge nobody because we know many will call out, Lord, Lord, and he will say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Also, when he said, he asked Peter, do you love me? He asked him that on three times. He said, feed my sheep. Uh-huh. All right. And it's not when you go out, you'll know when it's done for the glory of God, because you, as we saw on Sunday, you will see, you will reap of the harvest.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that's the evidence that God will show you.
Absolutely.
So, you know, it's not for your works to be seen. Everything, yes, as the deacon said, it's for God to be glorified.
That's right. That's right.
Whatever gifts he gives you, he says, listen, I want you to be faithful with what I give you. Mm-hmm. Anything that you're given, God expects us to be good stewards of it.
Mm-hmm.
According to the scripture, now maybe I read something wrong, but according to the scripture, he said, listen, if you be faithful with a little, I will bless you with much. And that's not material things, but the souls, again, as I revert back to, is the two souls that came into the house of God that I know that the angels were rejoicing, because not one, he gave us a double portion.
Yes, yes, yes.
Mm-hmm, he added a double portion to Shiloh. And what we do, we all have different functions. The body has many parts.
Right.
Right, but it's all to come together to edify the whole body.
That's it.
To edify the whole body. It's not one particular thing. It's two, three, four, whatever things working together to edify Christ. Although we may be a separate entity, but that entity was still working to edify the body.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And to build the kingdom. Kingdom builders. You know, so in that we have to understand that we don't want to misjudge, because judge not lest ye be judged. We have to be careful on how we speak and how we talk. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm, as mm-hmm. for me, it's not, whatever I do, I don't do for me, because I find joy in seeing somebody. I know, like I said, I know I have a passion for what I do. because it's real compassion for the people because I've been there. Mm-hmm. But it's not about me. It's not for me. I do it because the Lord has allowed me and entrusted me with some things that I have to be faithful with.
Right, that's right.
And that's what he calls us all to, just be faithful with the little. And he's going to continue to bless with much. But we can't be carnal-minded. If we're filled with the Spirit and we have discernment, then we know that God calls us to be faithful with what he gives us. Right. If I'm not, mm-hmm. listen, if I'm not in need, me and Deacon Ray was out talking to me. If I'm not in need, okay, and whether even if I am in need, as a believer, I trust God to address all my needs, and those that don't believe, we are going out to encourage them.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, amen. And you know, we just leave it at that, because we have to be real with the things we do. And we can go in, you know, when we're filled with the Spirit won't allow us to do different things. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, we'll follow the commandments, because the Spirit is going to lead us in all truth. And the truth is, the main command, when Jesus came, he didn't come to abolish the law. He came to fulfill it with love. That was the love. And that was the first fruit of the Spirit, was love. Because when you love, you don't do these other things. You don't hate. You don't covet. You don't backbite. There's no jealousy in the Spirit, in love. Mm-hmm. There's no anger in love. Yeah, like you said, there's going to be conflict, you know. But you resolve conflict, because that's why the scripture says, in all things, get understanding.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You have to get understanding. You have to know what was said, what was in the message, you know, because sometimes we'll hear a message and we don't listen to it, what we want to hear. That's the carnal mind. Mm-hmm. But God bless. And like I said, continue to pray for me as I continue to do the work for the Lord. Amen. Amen.
Absolutely, Minister. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Deacon Latham was speaking, and even when you, came on and just spoke, my mind went to a few scriptures. Amen. If y'all taking notes, those of you that are still on, still take notes, write down Romans chapter 8, verses 6 to 8. Romans chapter 8, verses 6 to 8. And they were talking about, Minister Best, as well as Deacon Latham was talking about that carnal mind. The scripture tells us what for the carnal, to be carnally minded is death. That's the last thing we want to be. Mm-hmm. Let me call them on it. But the spirit, to be spiritually minded, is what? Life and peace.
Life and peace.
Mm-hmm. And that's what we as saints of the Most High God are endeavoring to do. Amen. Conflicts will arise. Conflicts will come. But our first objective should be to diffuse it at all costs, immediately, as mm-hmm. quickly as possible. He goes on to say in that scripture, in verse number 7, he says, because what? Because the carnal mind is an enmity against God. Don't you know that you're mm-hmm. an enemy of God if you're carnal-minded? We're talking to somebody on tonight. Mm-hmm. If you're carnal mm-hmm. mind, all right? And for it's an enmity. You're an enemy of God. For it is not subject mm-hmm. what to the law of God, neither indeed can it be. Verse 8 goes on to say, so
yes.
They that are in the flesh cannot please God. That's why we got to be so careful.
My God.
When conflict comes our way, don't let the enemy take you out of your character of a child of the Most High God. Bishop touched on that. He said, and I love what he said earlier. He said, he said it actually in two phrases, but I wrote it down like this. We are held to a whole different higher standard or position of accountability. You mm-hmm. are. You're held to a different accountability. And just like I said mm-hmm. earlier, the world is watching you. They're looking at you. So anytime, you know, mm-hmm. when conflict comes our way, we don't do like the world do. Somebody stepped on your toe, somebody rubbed your shoulder, somebody may not have done something the way you thought they should have did it. You don't go off on them. We don't do that. We don't do that. Not as a child of the Most High God.
Amen.
All right?
Amen. Listen, amen. Listen, and another thing, real quick.
First Corinthians.
Uh-huh. Go ahead.
Hold on one second, Vincent. But it says, First Corinthians chapter 3:3, for ye are yet carnal. And for whereas there is among you envy and strife and division, are you not carnal and walking as men? We don't want to be found that to be found of us. Bishop said, I love what he said too. There's another thing he said, and if we're saved, we gotta act like we're saved.
You better.
And if you act in any other way, it's not of God. And you're not going where you think you're going. You know what? The slightest thing. That's why it's so careful for us to walk this walk of life every single day, because it could be the slightest of thing that can cause you to miss heaven.
Glory. Lord have mercy.
And I'm telling you, saints of God, don't let the enemy pull the wool over your heads while you have the breath of life in your body. I don't care how righteous or how right you think you are. Amen. Amen. The word he talks about, he could even fool the very elect. That's why we got to be careful. We got to do it. Minister Best talked about it. We got to do it in love. Even if you have a disagreement, come together, come reason together in love. Amen. This is resolving conflict. We still on our subject though tonight. Amen. Go ahead, Ms. Bess.
Yes.
You was gonna say something else? Praise God. Praise God. Listen, I bring it all back to scripture, man. It's in the word. If we cannot find ourselves in the word of God, amen. And accept. Listen, except when we're right, except when we're wrong, except our shortcomings. Somebody's got something on. Please cut that off. In the little music going or something.
You know, it was outside.
We've got a radio or something going on. I don't know who got it, but
I think I walked past. Somebody, I'm out here.
That's your fault.
I'm walking the track here. You know.
Okay.
My little while I'm on here doing my little, whatever. You know.
That's a blessing. Amen. Somebody else had something they want to share?
I want to say something.
Go ahead,
Bishop. I couldn't say amen you while you were speaking because my wife had me on mute. You said some good stuff there tonight, and you know it told you even talked about it ain't all about scripture.
My God.
Mm-hmm. You know, people gotta listen to you when you talk, and I love you know how you said that pastor is your pastor now.
Yes.
And we under him, we have to listen to his leadership.
Absolutely.
Amen.
You know what
Amen.
I'm saying? The people in the church have to listen to what you're saying.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
You know what I'm saying, Eddie? You know, I thought about it as you was talking. I said, man, I just talked about that. Tell the truth and shame the devil. But you shame the devil.
My God.
What you were saying, because it was all true.
It wasn't perfect. My God. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
Amen,
mm-hmm.
Bishop.
Amen. God bless you, sir. God bless you.
Amen. I must say, amen, even on the pastor. If the pastor walking and talking right, amen.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Amen. And that's what I'm endeavoring to do. I pray that, you know, we're walking and continue to walk and talk right, amen, and lead as God would direct us to go. Amen. Amen.
Yes.
Just like Bishop kind of alluded to earlier, amen. The enemy, he's mad, y'all. Amen. God is doing a great work, and guess what? Even greater is coming. Praise God.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. And we're not going to let the devil in no way, type, shape, or form or fashion get any type of foothold anywhere in regards to the work that God has called us to do. Amen?
That's right. Amen. That's right. Amen.
Praise God.
Like you said, the devil is mad because what happened when you're doing out there and you're doing ministry, you're doing the work of the Lord. We went out and did the outreach and people growing because reaching out.
Yeah.
You reach out to people. They had some gifts, some manna, and it drew them.
Mm-hmm.
And the devil is mad because what happened is, see, he likes to walk in the dark. He likes darkness.
Yeah. Yes, he does.
He's lurk okay. around where you think you can't see him. But when you shine a light on him, like you said, we should be like a beacon.
Yeah.
You know, shine a light, and the light shine. And, you know, people came.
Yes, they did.
And my heart that more people are going to come, and not just from that area there. People are gonna come there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, you might have to fill your bus up with some people. Might have to fill that bus up.
But it's on. I don't know about that. If I fill that bus up with people, they're not gonna fit in shallow.
Well, that's gonna be overflow.
That's good. I'm telling you. That's gonna be. I tell you, it's not good. I'm telling you, but they are coming. They are coming. Amen. Souls for the kingdom. Amen. God be praised. Amen.
Yeah. You had some people inquire on today where we at. They may show up Sunday.
Oh, praise God. Amen. Thank God. God be praised. Amen. All right.
Well, Pastor, that's all right. We just take them on outside. We'll be out there in the yard. We'll be right in the yard.
Put some tents up. Huh?
We got a big enough yard. Amen. Right about that, Bishop.
Put some chairs out there. We got a sound system. We got sound systems.
We sure do. Yes, we do. Yes, we do.
We go ahead and let it be. Let it be.
That's it. Glory to God.
Yes.
Amen. All right. Anybody else have a question, a comment real quick before we cut off? Amen. We thank God. Amen. Lester, you're muted. You got to hit the little earphone thing on your app to take the mute. If you push the little, it looks like a little earphone icon. Tap that little thing to unmute it. It's an earphone. Looks like a little set of earphone, a little round thing. You should be able to push that. It'll unmute you. I don't think it says unmute. I think it's a little earphone icon on the app. Probably towards the bottom. Check the bottom. All right. You don't see the little earphones? All right. Ask somebody for help over there if you can. I know. I think Minister Deacon. I think he's itching to say something. Yeah. We thank God. Thank God for you, Sister Wanda, for joining us. I know you came on a little late. And everybody, amen. Amen. Pastor Bird. God bless you. Amen. Everybody.
Sorry.
Amen. Thank God.
Sorry, guys. Praise the Lord.
God bless you.
Praise the Lord.
God bless you. Go ahead.
Sometimes when, like I said before, when you really real for God and you're trying to be strong, so when the devil comes, he comes like a flood and trying to hinder you from what you have to do for Christ.
My Lord.
Mm-hmm. So yep. My decision is to stick with the word of God and let people know who I am to the word of God. So that's how it's going to be.
All right.
Because you can't allow the devil come in if that person said they got the Holy Ghost and don't really mean for their own self. You know what I mean? So you got to be really careful, like the bishop was saying to us.
Yes.
Y'all hear me?
Yes, we hear you.
Now we do.
Okay. So, like I'm saying, if you're not real for God, why are you saying that you don't need to believe this, you don't believe that? Because you're helping that person and love that person to be going down. That's because you got the Holy Ghost. I'm saved. And I'm stuck with the word of God, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's easy to fall to let the devil ride. Amen?
My Lord. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. I remember, I think it was Baytops used to sing that song, "Don't Let the Devil Ride."
Mm-hmm.
Let him ride, he going to want to drive. Amen.
Oh, yeah. He will do it.
Don't let him ride. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. We thank God. That's right. We want to stay in the word of God. Amen.
Exactly.
In the word of God, we have life. Amen.
Well, ain't no time that's allow the devil to take over. Mm-hmm. You're going to do it anyhow.
That's what he want to do. Mm-hmm. But greater is he that is in us. Amen.
Yes, yes.
Amen. We thank God. Amen. It's been good. Amen. Just real quick before we cut off. Amen. I just thank God for each and every one of you. We did have a slight late start tonight, but we thank God for you. Anybody else, amen, have a question or comment, want to share real quick before we cut off? If not, we're going to get ready to close on out. Amen. I'm going to ask on tonight about, amen, Sister Wanda Staples, take us out in prayer. Sister Wanda. looking good on there. I see you. Amen. We thank God for you. Amen. Praise God. Keep it, Brother Frankie, lifted up too in your family. Amen. Praise God. Amen. We was talking, me and somebody was talking about Brother Frankie other day. He said it's a good day. And I love what he used to say, it's a good day to be above ground. Brother Frankie. Amen. This is another day's a good day.
Sister Wanda. Yes.
Sister Wanda,
this is Sandra. Listen, as you go out of prayer tonight, could you remember my husband? He may have to go into another surgery on Monday. And so y'all keep him lifted up, and I want you to call his name out in prayer tonight.
Okay.
Randy, amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for Bible study this evening.
Thank you
for every person that participated. Thank you, Lord, for your word.
Yes, Lord.
You know, we don't want your word to ever return void, Lord. We thank you for each and everyone here. Lord, we ask you to bless everyone. Lord, we ask you to look on Ramsey Cardwell, who's supposed to have another surgery. Lord, we ask you to touch his body, Lord.
Touch him, God.
Help him and keep him, strengthen him, Lord. Help him, help his faith, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Anyone that's sick on this call tonight, I ask you to touch them, Lord. Touch their bodies. Touch their minds. Touch their hearts, Lord.
Lord,
we thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done, because, Lord, you've been so good to us.
Yes, Lord.
And we cannot thank you enough for all of your goodness, your kindness, your mercy. No, we can't thank you enough. And we thank you for all of it, Lord, because we know with you, we can do anything. We can be anything. Lord, we thank you for it all. Yes, in the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you. Awesome. This has been wonderful on tonight. Amen. We pray this blessing. Yes. Do us a big favor. Like, share, and subscribe. Amen. On the YouTube channel. Amen. The Bible study. Share it with somebody else. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Don't keep this blessing to yourself.
Thank you.
Amen. Listen, beloveds, amen. Until next time, I pray that y'all have a great evening or day. Those of you maybe watching this recording, amen. We pray God's peace and blessings be upon you. Amen. And until next time, amen. Take care. God bless.
Amen.
God bless everybody.
God bless you all. God bless you all.
Amen.
God bless.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Yes.